writing post, as some were saying. So if you want to put them together in that sense, then you may want to put some analysis to it that it wasn't a direct response to Sir Sam Jonah, but he may have said it to respond to issues that has happened within the period.
Okay.
Which right. happens, which what Sir Sam Jonah said may have happened to
the coincide with. Yeah. Yes. Okay. The argument's going to be, of course, that, you know what, Mr. President, you go to university, they give you a doctorate, you spend the time to say, and I hope that others like myself and you youngsters who have gotten some free SHS will also use this opportunity to seek for higher learning because I'm giving you free SHS. Leave it there. What are you thinking, Mark?
I think it is one of the best opportunities for the president to have responded, most especially when Sir Jonah was right there with him. Communication is when I talk and you also respond, not necessarily in a bigotry way or we fighting, but in a more responsive way for people to understand the concept from which we are talking about. And so he's criticized that, you know, there's been a culture of silence, and the president sees that not to be true. And getting that opportunity to respond, I think ever since Jonah made those, you know, revelations, the president had never said anything about this until he was being honored with the degree that was conferred on him in UCC. So, for me, I think it's one of the platforms, and there's nothing wrong about that.
Since when has a convocation or an event of this nature been used as a place to make political points?
Okay, they do.
Yeah?
They do, yeah.
And
they
does
do.
That make that appropriate?
It is not necessarily making that appropriate. You see, there are preliminaries when one wants to give a speech, like Otunfo did the other day.
Yeah,
so I think he said that, of course, people are saying he shouldn't have said it, but it was very needful. It was very important he said that.
Okay.
And so the president responding to it, I think it's
fine.
Yeah.
Okay, all right. Fred, your thoughts?
Yes, could you, I think that the culture of silence now is for the president not to speak, and we are gagging him. And probably, if you flip the coin, then we are saying that if anybody makes a criticism against government functionaries or governments are stopped from responding. The president hadn't said anything ever since this news broke out. Said Jonah hadn't having the platform. He also had a platform, and he enumerated a number of issues that concern him. And so, for me, the president's desire for free speech has been known to Ghanaians and the world over. And so if one of his cardinal political points of taking away the issue of, what do you call it, the
culture of silence.
The culture of silence, but during President Kufuor's time when the speech was
decriminalized.
I mean, this is a man who had spearheaded the removal of the criminal libel law from our statutes.
Mm-hmm.
And so a couple of decades after he's been accused of introducing culture of silence, it's a bit paradoxical.
How is it paradoxical?
It is paradoxical because if he has been championing free speech and has decriminalized speech, and today we are telling the same person that he's introducing a culture of silence, he needs to say something about it. I think it was right.
The appropriate.
It was appropriate. That was
the platform, yeah?
For the platform, he was given a doctorate degree, honorary doctorate
you
degree.
Say thank you and go away.
No.
I don't understand. Does he have to deliver a speech on culture?
You have to respond because.
Why?
I mean,
was he invited there to address the culture of silence?
No, he was invited there to be honored.
Yes, so and take your honor.
In that honor, various it is his entire life history that has come to this point to be honored.
Right.
And one of the cardinal points in President Akufo-Addo's life history is the removal of the criminal libel law.
Okay.
He's fought throughout with his life.
Yeah.
And now that he's the president, he's been accused of introducing criminal libel law. And if he has opportunity like this, I'm sure it's right. Let's not gag him. Let's not. If the culture of silence, then we are asking government officials to be silent, even if they are being criticized either rightly or wrongly. Mm. You need to come out and, albeit, respond with the decorum that it deserves. Mm. I think he did well.
He did well, yeah. Okay. All right. Nana, do you think he did well? I thought that I'm just asking, really, not so much about the words, but whether there was the right forum. And it seems to me that everybody seems to think, yeah, he should have just gone ahead. What do you think?
I think a strategic decision has been taken to use big set piece speeches made by the president that may actually be useful platforms for discussing various things on which to date he has not given a response or a direct response. Perhaps, you know, people from the Ministry of Information might have replied in the past to arguments put forward about free SHS or not. Latterly, the most vigorous defense of his policy, his agenda, and his ideas that the president will have made would have been in the lead up to election 2020. Since then, for various reasons of, first of all, a court case that has held up the formation and the settling of a government by whatever it was, 3 months, and secondarily by some slowness in putting a full machinery of government into motion, to do with the wheels of government cranking up again. And also some necessary travel we'd seen him have to do recently, going to France, Belgium, and South Africa. He has not been seen to be attending directly to certain things to do with the domestic agenda, which is very often what leaders get accused of. You know, they're too busy traveling, they're globe trotting, they're not attending to the things that mean something to you and me. So I think what he is doing at the moment, and it's a decision that has clearly been made, has been that at certain occasions, which may not be related, it may not have been a forum called to discuss the business of press freedom. Mm-hmm. But the person who gave the lecture that originally launched the whole discussion was actually sitting there on the platform in his capacity as Chancellor of the University of Cape Coast and smiling beatifically on the occasion and not seeming to imply that there was anything particularly amiss. And so I think the president deliberately chose the occasion to respond directly to the person who made the original allegation about the return of a culture of silence.
Okay.
I don't necessarily agree with all the terms that he used to discuss the question. I thought the personalized bits were a little bit close to the bone, but I can understand the strategic importance of going straight to the source of the argument.
Right. Okay, I got you. So you're okay, and it seems that then we have an agreement that the timing, the platform was okay, but Nana just has a little bit of a challenge with how close it got to. For me, then address very quickly before we move on. Gentlemen, for me, and I disagree with all of you, but then that's normal, I have these challenges. Look, when Sir Sam Jonas spoke, he spoke specifically, and he said categorically, not in terms of military or legal imposition of a culture of silence, but now through parochialism, convenience. That's what he described as being the culture of silence. All right, so nothing to do with the knock on the door at midnight, which then the president referred to. So did the president actually address what was Sam Jonas' actual issue?
Could you? We know the genesis of culture of silence.
Doesn't matter. I can use the phrase any way I want. I've told you how I'm using it.
No.
You address what I've talked about, which is that media houses are being bought so that they don't talk.
Could you?
That there are people who should speak about challenges within government who, because of parochial interest, selfish self-interest, do not speak. And that is how you describe the culture of silence. So it's nothing to do with it.
I'm telling you whose watch.
No, you see.
Yes, but whose definition?
We have.
Definition. I'm telling you what the man said.
Yes, that's what I'm saying. But whose definition? That is what he's saying.
He could have said all these things without referencing the culture of silence.
Why the culture of silence?
I can't use the
phrase.
It's a bit like using the word Holocaust to describe a car accident.
Okay, all right. I think you've just gone a little bit hyperbolic right there, but no problem.
No. We've had it recently on the program.
So we live in the culture of silence that Professor Edu Buahin had to break with that historic speech. And we know the what people had gone through, what journalists had gone through. Some of them lost their lives. Some of them were in prison. Some of them can't, as we speak, some of them cannot be found for speaking their mind, for just speaking. That was a terrible, horrific period of our national life. I think that since the days of Nkrumah's PDA, the culture of silence is one period that really put the fear of God, the fear of the military and the powers that be into journalism and into free speech.
Okay.
So to reference it in your, if you like, in your...
in your deliberations at a Rotary Club event.
In your deliberations at saying that people who are responding or people... He used them, the dogs, the attacking dogs come and respond to you. And on social media, so people are cowed into bringing out what they are saying.
Yes,
it is not the military that is coming to you.
Yes. Okay, and so what's wrong with that? What's wrong with what he said? And tell me that what he said was not true and is not true in this country.
You see, assuming without admitting that it is true,
yes,
the phrase culture of silence connotes a certain mindset.
Understood.
Yes. And so bringing it back and say that this is the culture of silence. Culture of silence was a government deliberate
sponsored
policy.
Plan. Yeah. Okay.
So he says that as a president, he has not introduced any culture of silence. And there's no proof to that effect. If people are responding to vitriolics about statements that others have made and making their, no matter how strong they are. And the president went ahead to say he's better off having a media that is irresponsible than a government that is too powerful. And so he needed to really balance it.
Okay.
The platform, you can argue whether it was right or wrong, but this is if the president is speaking, wherever he gets a platform and whatever statement that he thinks he wants to bring it out, I think it is in his right.
All right.
Yeah, I think...
You approve of the policy of using a hammer to kill a mosquito. Unless it's... Go on.
I think that, to be fair to Sir Sam Jonah, he was very categorical when he spoke about the culture of silence. And he mentioned the universities. I mean, we all read PAV and Sense going to town articles at the time. And he's saying that now the academics are no longer speaking. I mean, he categorized it. He did not kind of generalize it as we wanted to look now. It was very categorical that the universities are not speaking any longer. The things we heard, the desire to hear academics spoke, and, I mean, call for action and people happy to hear it is no longer happening. So what is the issue? So for me, I think that that is very specific.
The phraseology culture of silence may have been misapplied because, of what it connotes.
Yeah. Yeah.
No problem. Yeah. But did the president, and again, you guys have all said that he was right to speak on that platform.
No.
My question is only simply, did the president actually address what Sam Jonah actually said?
To take a cue from Nanaya, the president has been away for some time and he wants to address home issues that people thought is silent over. So, yes, it's the president who stops him from saying what he's saying. But I think that the occasion was not fully right for some of the things that were said.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
You don't think
I thought right. That the full focus would have been on education and nothing else but education and the quality of education, which confronts us, if you ask me.
Right, okay. So do you think the president addressed what... I can interpret as what Sam Jonah meant. And I'm being very clear. I'm only going with what Sir Sam Jonah actually said. He was very clear that he's not talking about legal and military pushback or censorship or whatever. He was talking now about a new culture of silence. And I get the connotation being wrong. But did the president actually address what Sir Sam Jonah actually said?
Uncle Joe, the president addressed categorically. Yes, and very clear what Sir Sam Jonas said. Now, he was referring to not probably bringing in issues of military and what have you, but then academians are now not talking about some ill happenings within our system. Besides, there are people who are expected to, who expected that their voices are to be heard, but we are not hearing them. Now, if he's saying that this is a new silence of culture of silence, it may be new to someone like me who was born in the late 80s. When referencing history that I've come to read, that in a situation where culture of silence is experienced is when people are not able to come out with dissenting views. And immediately you come out with your statement or you utter words, the least you could do to yourself is to find a way to leave the country or you will be killed. And people never spoke about these things. These are historical things that I have come to read. But in this dispensation, if Sir Sam Jonas is talking about parochial interest, about people not speaking, it is personal to themselves. And Sir Sam Jonas have been here in Ghana before I was even born. And if I have perhaps not heard of him for quite a long time, then it means that he was in Ekana minding his own business. And I could also refer that to a parochial interest. I don't want to sound so, but he not also speaking for quite a long time for us, the new upcoming ones, to also hear. We can also refer that to one of the bureaucrat attributes he was attributing to people who are not talking as to the ill happenings in our society. Of course, yes, nobody has gone to knock at anybody's door that I want to kill you, or what happened to Bafua Nkuma, an editor of the Pioneer newspaper, when he published a story about the state of the nation. What happened to him? And did people talk about that? Was he not fired?
So, in conclusion, Mark, apart from just getting wound up, what's your...
We don't leave any catch of silence, as Sir Sam Jonas talked about. Because even in our own confined zone, I can pick up my phone, speak, and it goes viral. You see, you can be guaranteed freedom of speech. But freedom of speech cannot be guaranteed. We are in a country that has to be governed with ethics. You understand? And so there are certain things you cannot come on air to say and think you go scot-free when it goes against certain individuals, especially the executive or government. And of course, yes, they will not come after you. But it is about giving or criticizing them constructively. If you criticize constructively and they think they have any response, as the president had done, they will quickly do that. And so it's not about sending wet dogs on you or asking people to come and respond on social media and all that. When you speak and people have responses to give you, I think it doesn't fall out of place to respond.
Well, I...
Okay, all right.
I think that...
I'm giving you 1 minute. You've already made
I think that the academics not coming out from, say, Sam Jonas' assertion that academics are no more speaking like they used to. You know, nature abhors vacuum. At a point during the culture of silence, journalists were not speaking. The academia had sort of some assurance that they can come out and speak. Now the media is all over. Anybody at all can pick up a video and then go viral. And so probably the academics are now concentrating on what they are required to do. That is research, teaching, and learning. That's what they record to do, rather than coming to the public to respond to issues that others are already talking about anyway.
Okay, fine. So we're still sort of divided on that one a little bit. Did you think the president, very briefly, Nana, do you think he addressed specifically what Sam Jonas might have been getting at? Forgetting about the connotation of culture of silence, the phrase itself, and what it might mean to those of us who are a little bit older. But in real terms, did the president actually focus on what Sir Sam Jonas might have been intending from his comments?
Well, to to aim your own question back at you, because was it the appropriate forum for him to have gone into a disquisition line by line, an analysis of Sam Jonah's speech? I think not. I think what the president wanted to do was use the occasion to address two big questions. One was free SHS, which was entirely appropriate, given the setting, the honour that was being conferred on him, the fact that it was at the University of Cape Coast, which is one of our premier institutions in terms of research into education, and indeed hard work that has gone into the effectiveness of the free SHS policy, as the president himself described in his speech. The genesis of a lot of those ideas came from such learned characters as Professor Jerome Jangma, and the work that he has done for years researching into education and pushing the idea of what Ghana needs to do as a country to expand mass provision of secondary level education, not looking at the hoity-toities, and the examples of prime excellence, but how you expand opportunity to the greatest number of people possible. That was one subject. The business of the culture of silence was to do with, if you like, I won't say the opportunistic setting, the serendipity of the setting and some of the characters who were present. That the Chancellor of the University of Cape Coast is Sam Jonah. It was clear that in the course of the conferment of this degree, the president was going to have a direct meeting with somebody who had lately launched a discussion that has, kind of had everybody in the land wanting to present their opinion. It would have been distinctly odd if the president had provided no response at all to Sir Sam Jonah's recent argument. But was it the forum really to go line by line through the speech and deal with every single point, the speech in toto? No.
Okay. All right. Exactly 9 o'clock. We're talking. We just finished concluding our little chat on El Presidente's speech. And interesting that he spent that much time on Oli Sam Jonah's speech. Perhaps you should do the same thing when Kelvin Taylor talks, or anybody else talks, or Captain Smart talks, or anybody else. Why Sam Jonah?
Has Kelvin Taylor launched a national debate?
Oh, no, stop. I'm just saying. These are all people who talk.
Kevin Taylor.
Kevin, he's made us clear about that as well. No, but I'm just saying. What do you address and what do you not address? And for me, that was the big challenge, is that which report are you... But then again, you say it's Sam Jonah, you think maybe that's more important. Did we lose some of the celebration of the fact of the honorary degree because of what the president said? I can tell you that we did, for the simple reason that nobody actually commented to tell me what the degree was for. Because everybody...
No, I thought we'll get
to
that.
We did. Because
that's what I want to...
I'm talking about the media after the fact.
Oh, okay.
Did they even bring,
As radio did.
Did we do as much as we could have done in actually letting people know why the president went to University College of Cape Coast? Cape Coast College?
University.
Did we get that?
Not so much. I mean, I think a lot was said before the ceremony.
Right.
I've not heard so much after the ceremony, but a lot was said before the ceremony. And for me, my biggest joy was that they were able to correct the honorary degree awarded, because before the ceremony, what I saw severally in the media was Doctor of Philosophy in Management and Leadership in Education, which I heard it for the first time, because the right thing was leadership and management. So I was wondering whether Cape Coast does something different from what the rest of the world does. Until Saturday, when the conferment was made, then I see Doctor of Philosophy in Education Leadership, which was okay. First, they were missing the leadership and management and leadership, which was not proper. So now the right thing was done.
So you're happy.
And I'm very happy.
Okay.
We
accept that.
Yes, the title as was rightly put. I'm sure they saw it, that they were doing something out of that.
Right.
But the thing Oh, I thought you want us to get into...
No, I want us to finish this. I've had
to get into what the culture of silence still?
No, but it's the same thing. So
to get into what the essence of the awards, the 100...
I just wanted to know whether we missed the essence of it because of the media talk around what he actually said. Did Ghanaians lose the whole point of why he was getting a degree?
I think there was a lot of mixed... there was a lot of issues in the president's speech, which I said that whether he did it himself or was written for him, the focus would have been very well out there if he dwelled only on education. But a lot of things were missed up. And I think it's giving people a mixed feeling on the reaction. Because again, the free SHS, when the president talked about the culture of silence, some media houses were running the free SHS to be of inferior quality and not up to what it is. And that was also fine space in the speech, which didn't go well with people because, we can all trace back to what finance minister have said before about people going to school for virtually free and not paying anything. He gave an example to himself, dropping off his children at school and not paying anything and doesn't know how they are fed or anything is done. He said it. Even the Minister of Education recently said that if parents want to pay money to the schools, they should go ahead and do it. They will take it. Okay. So the issue of quality, which the president responded to.
I'm not going to let that one go. That's the most irresponsible statement that anybody can make. Go to the school and just give them the money, if you like.
Yeah.
I mean, when where's the accounting?
He said they will be happy for it. They will take it and they'll be happy for it.
Please go on.
So that the free SHS, which found space in the president's speech, I'm saying that, and I've said it time and again, that I'm yet to see a single Ghanaian who is not for the free SHS. Everybody likes it. What the discussion has been is the quality. Because I'm sure people have compared, because you know, when you are paying, then you can demand certain things. But when it's free, then it's like whatever is given to you, you have to accept it. And that is what people have issues with. God, now you can't get up and say that the food is not good, the food is not good. God, the rhetorical response will be, what do you pay for it?
Okay, all right. All right, understood. You know, when you started using mobile phones, what phone were you using?
Oh, Nokia 3310.
Exactly, and what phone are you using now?
Samsung.
Yeah, so like with everything else, you've got to start from somewhere and improve, no?
Of course, definitely.
I would think that logic should apply to anybody who wants to think about this.
Definitely. Maybe the speed with which they want to see
the change,
the quality is what maybe dragging. Right. Maybe. Because and, you know, usually when they see, I mean, people make comparisons. When you see certain things being done at certain places and certain things not being done at certain places. I mean, people say, oh, people go to parliament and their ex gratia in 4 years is this, their loans are this. And then we begin to make comparisons.
Okay.
If these children will go to school and become the future leaders, why don't we rather put more resources in
their way?
So those things leads to certain comparisons.
Right. Anything to do with education, Niyama just doesn't stop talking. Mark, what are your thoughts?
Yes, Uncle Joe, I think we live in a country where it's good to confer honorary, you know, doctorate degrees on people, but we also need to look at the benefits that comes with it. For me, on that platform, it was a personal degree conferred on the president. And when we're looking at the broader picture, what each and every Ghanaian is to benefit from, then of course, yes, we can attribute it to the free SHS, where my brother Ni, they talked about that. He's yet to see or hear who says the policy or the free SHS is not, you know, a good thing. Of course, it's a good thing. But I believe we are in a developing country. Despite the fact that we have stayed quite too long to ensure that we put in certain measures to, you know, propel our developmental progress or agenda into the next future, that someone will just come up to say that, oh yes, we said this, that we'll be doing and we've been able to do that. Or we're projecting that in the next 4 or 5 years, this is what we expect our educational sector to be. And of course, we've been able to do it. Again, the president made a statement that free SHS, you know, has enhanced access to education. And for me, I have some sort of challenges with that.
And is it enhanced, sorry?
Yes, enhanced access to education. Right. Yes, I have a little challenge with that simply because it is within these 4 years that we've been able to implement the free SHS and policy. So have we gone back to look at the positives and the negatives? Has the positive outweighed the negatives or the negative outweighed the positive? So when we're able to sit down and then go into all these things, then we can conclude by saying that, yes, it has enhanced. But the president maybe had people who have gone to do that research for him. But does it really... is it really seen on the grounds when you look at responses coming from schools, responses coming from people, responses coming from the students themselves? So when we're able to, you know, put all these comments about the policy together, then we can say that it is true that it has enhanced education, or it is not true. But, you know, since we are a developing country, of course, yes, we move forward. There are hinges that we need to go prepare ourselves for, come back and then do it. But the conscience that we should have as a people in ensuring that not just free SHS, but any other sector of the economy that we decide to work on would give it our utmost best and ensure that we're able to push those agendas forward.
Mm.
And for that, when we are conferring such, you know, honorary degrees on people, the whole country will come and say that, yes, you deserve it. But as we speak, there are a lot of people who have dissenting views on the policy. As we said, the finance minister, that how do I go leave my children and come back? What they eat also becomes, you know, something that he is to think about. But some people may not be thinking about that. How do we even call for accountability when we've not also, you know, contributed, that the contribution is coming just from the central government.
Mm-hmm.
That is not any argument to, you know, just oppose whether the policy is good or it is not good. But in the long run, for us to have the free SHS being an enhanced, you know, project to education, we should also be aware that there are challenges, and the challenges must not outweigh
Saying that the president shouldn't have spoken about it at this convocation? I mean,
he was to speak about it. But what I'm saying is that,
and has it not enhanced access to education?
No.
I mean, I get what you're saying, mm-hmm. that there must be studies done to see how brilliant it's been. Mm-hmm. But yes, at a very basic level, if something is free, does that not invite more people to access it?
Oh, yes, it invites more people to access it. That's, but we're looking at the quality of it as well.
I don't know that the president was required to address the quality at this particular moment.
It should be included.
He enhanced access. That's all he spoke about.
No, but it must not be just the enhancement of but at least the qualitiness of it is also to be considered.
I'm not arguing with you that there must be more to it when we're reporting in our report card on free SHS. But at the moment of speaking, is the president wrong to say that free SH, that access to education has been enhanced?
Yes,
that's see. Is he wrong or right?
For that, he's right. He is right. But what I'm saying is that there are certain challenges.
What Mark is saying, that we shouldn't leave it only as
hanging at the
access enhancement, but also talk about the quality, which is very important. But I think he gave some statistics. Which he said of all those who did well, who are now known as Akufo-Addo's graduates, got 411 out of the 460 something.
Which came came about a month ago, and we've boasted about that already, and we've already challenged them. It's a great achievement that graduates they topped West Africa. That's And we know this, 411 out of 521, I think it was. Brilliant statistics.
Yeah, but you see, sometimes what my thinking is, don't just leave it at. So what happened to like the 70, 80,000 who do not also gain access to the next level? What's the plan for them?
One thing at a time. Okay.
Fred,
go to the break.
I think that the University of Cape Coast is the institution that trains educational professionals. So you see all the universities, the public universities, Cape Coast focuses on education itself.
Mm-hmm.
And so, and the conferment was directly linked to education issues. Mm. So it was right in that sense. Enhancing the numbers. Mm. I don't see how we can even argue about that. These facts are known, that it has helped to enhance enrollment. It's known. Quality, yes. It's important.
Is it something the president should have addressed very specifically in terms of quality?
Yes. Well, this is this has been on for about 4 years. This is the fifth year. Mm-hmm. And government is rolling out projects across the country in all these things. So, yes, quality is important. But the end product, the first batch that came out, showed clearly that they have gone through the education and come out with what is required. Three out of the best, the best three candidates in West Africa came from Ghana.
And this never happened before.
It's never happened before. Yeah. It's never happened before. So when you come to talk about quality...
Oh, is that true?
Yes.
Oh, first no. In the SHS level or in the West Africa examination?
In the West Africa examination.
Oh, no. It's not.
I'm very surprised. Not,
no,
I'd
no,
be very surprised because even back in the day when we were in school.
Yeah, that's it. We were not doing even wonders. My preparatory school, Cambridge. I mean, for several years, stopped the whole West Africa.
Cambridge. We are looking at.
Okay, but anyway.
I mean, West Africa examination as a whole.
We're looking at WASI.
Okay, that's what I asked specifically. Now, if you say WASI, we can.
We're not looking at A level or O level.
Yeah, good. When you say WASI, we can.
Fred, my problem is, are you linking that directly with the free SHS? And I want to be clear. Are you saying that it's because of free SHS that's why we got better results at WASI?
The result that just came.
Yes.
Result of. Free SHS graduates. They are a result that is coming out of graduates who went through the free SHS course.
They didn't go through a free SHS course. Don't do that. They went through the same course that every other child before free SHS was going through. There's no such thing as a free SHS course.
What I mean to say, let me make myself clearer, is that this batch
had gone through
They've gone through the free SHS.
But does that make them better students?
Mr. Minister, you see, a proper study or a proper analysis will be, all these free SHS are pro-poor interventions, okay? Just to make sure that those who cannot afford also are able to get opportunity to enter secondary school. So a proper study will be that how many of such category of people or that community of people also did very well, which otherwise they wouldn't have done.
But if you are counting those who did best, West Africa, from
Achimota School, in Fancy Pain, Presec, and all those places which are already fortunate then we are not looking at the pro-poor who are supposed to have benefited from the policy. Because it's a pro-poor thing. So let's go back. Let's go to places like Jamestown, like Bukom, like Mamprobi, like Chemwena, like all those places. Let's look at those who went into the free SHS, who wrote the exam, and what they got, and has transformed them, or in the process of transferring them from the poor.
There's a
I was getting possessed.
There's a young man in, is it in
Sawam, thereabouts? Yes, he's in the UK.
Who had how many?
No, but you're talking about ratios. One out of a million.
Thank goodness. In the same way, the quality that we are talking about, it's just the few schools. If you take the number of secondary schools that we have, you have 1, 2, 3, maybe 10% of schools don't have the infrastructure that is needed and overcrowding and all of it. But majority of them, especially when the double track system came in.
Right.
The numbers were reduced. So we have challenges. And the president means no words in saying that the free SHS has challenges. Okay. Everybody knows it has challenges. When there was no free SHS, those of us who went through the O level and A level stuff, there were challenges. There were people who could not come to school, who could not pay their fees. And it's not just for proper. If it is free SHS, it's for everybody, whether you are rich or you are poor. Everybody has to go through, just
but
like we are bringing. The
intention of the policy. Okay.
The policy is to provide a greater access for a larger number of young people who deserve to get schooling. I think that it's a, but it's a pro-poor policy. That's the only people who were not getting access were those who could not afford it. It's a pro-poor policy.
So I'm saying that the better study will be, let's go and see how many of those people
were transferred. If you are looking at just the poor, then you say, okay, those who come.
Not just the poor.
Oh, get a statistic, Dr. Fred, get a statistic and see those who got a 411. You see the schools they are coming from. I know some.
But there are people who are going, who are also coming from poor backgrounds.
Yes, and the ratio, let's look at the ratio. How many of them?
Access and gotten admission.
Yes, I don't dispute that. I agree, Dr. Fred, but I'm saying let's look at the ratios. Because if the thing is focused towards those who do not have, they have nots. Let's see how many of them we've transformed through the process.
Okay. Mark, I'm 1 minute. We're going to the break. You want to say something?
I don't think he'll say. He'll give his minute to me. Because this is education.
let me say something. But you see, for gaining access to education under the free SHS policy, of course, it will give thumbs up to the government.
No child should be left behind.
No child should be left behind. But
not poor, not rich.
The sure. But the outcome of the students that have enjoyed this benefit is what we are looking at. I made mention of reports coming from the students themselves, from schools, and of course, yes, there are challenges. It has been there, it is here now, and it shouldn't continue that we say it will be there tomorrow. And so, in running a project, you look at your school. So if today we are saying that we have chopped success, at what time did we start it? And what are the elements that contribute to the successes that we have chopped within this policy that we introduced? The finance minister, as I indicated earlier on,
I gave you 1 minute. Said that, you're not going to give me a lecture. No.
Oh, 1 minute. It's not up to 1 minute. When you get to 1 minute, I'll stop. Yeah. But you've taken 3 seconds. So the finance minister made this aware that, look, you take them there, but he sees that whoever can afford should be able to do that. And it is part of the system we are running when it comes to the free SHS policy. And so if there should be some reviews to ensure that, okay, those who are able to afford could be given the opportunity, and those who, of course, will be given the full proper, you know, intervention would be able to also have access, it will all come together in building the enhancement that we're talking about when it comes to the enrollment of students in the free SHS policy. So to me, let's also look at the quality of it and then do a proper analysis and research as to whether we've been able to chop success or not.
Okay, so the important thing would appear, at least from me and Mark, is that there must be some serious research and some data and statistical analysis about what these results actually mean in reality. Could it just have been that we had a very good year for the cleverest children who are already in the best schools? Or is it that because of the enhanced access, granting more youngsters the chance to go to school, our results are a result of that. It's difficult to say yes to either side on this one because we just don't have the data.
The data.
Yes, so we need.
I know a study is being conducted.
So when we are done with the evaluation,
what we can say categorically that 411 children topped.
Yeah.
And they all came from Ghana.
Ghana, yes.
And as a percentage number from the rest of West Africa, that is huge. But those who didn't pass, those who just didn't make the grade, those who are just going to get some very dodgy marks, they still exist. Yeah. Are those numbers increased because those kids who just went through Basabi like that? Mm-hmm. We don't know.
That's the point. I agree so much.
If the last result that came, Ghana had 20% or 10% best of West Africa.
More than 20%. Yeah.
Best out of West Africa.
the conclusion.
You are doing an extrapolation which you're you should not do. It's not empirical.
I'm waiting for Dr. Fred to finish. I'll respond to him.
The conclusion would have been that it is because of the poor nature of free SHS education. That is why Ghana had done poorly. Now we are having almost 81%, and we are still complaining.
Okay. No, Dr. Fred, you are talking about those who got to the top. We're talking about those who did not gain access.
You guys just don't want me to actually end the conversation, so we're going to take a break. We'll come back and we'll talk some more in just a moment.
Join Prince Moses on Asasa Business PM with Felix, Oswald, Josiah, and Kweku every Monday for Tech Talk, a dive into our digital world where we bring you solutions, cheeky critiques, features, and analyses of all things tech. We need a woman on this show, don't we?
Business PM from 6 to 6:30 PM on weekdays on Asasi Radio 99.5.
From oil to gas to hydro to renewables, it is all about energy. Energy, the power behind Ghana's development agenda. Energy, the driving force behind the nation's industrialization. Energy. Without it, the country cannot move forward. Every Monday, between 7 and 8 p.m., join Emmanuel Abuajiriafi for Energy 101, where you and I learn about our energy reserves, new initiatives in the field, the challenges faced, and how we are managing our resources. Energy 101 brings you an in-depth look at how Ghana is building its energy capacity, developing new sources of energy, and how we are managing our energy. Every Monday between 7 and 8 p.m. Tune in to Asasi Radio 99.5 for Energy 101. Our future, our present.
Beautiful Minds is on 99.5 Asasi Radio. Mondays from 8 p.m. is for your psychological well-being. How to get some if you need help. How to keep it if you're losing it. How to manage and enhance a healthy state of mind for psychological well-being. That's Beautiful Minds on 99.5 Asasi Radio. Mondays from 8 p.m. Beautiful Minds for psychological well-being.
Asasi Radio 99.5.
Sanitize, mask up, and keep your social distance. Abba! Be safe, oh, so all of us goofy be safe from corona.
A public service announcement from Asasi Radio.
The Asasi Breakfast Show.
Trying hard to get control of this discussion, failed miserably. We have other issues to discuss, but before we do that, Nana.
Yes, Goyle has a message for us. Goyle higher grade fuels have been tried, tested, proven, and accepted over the years as most suitable for all engine types, including the latest vehicles with the most modern engines. In addition to these superior qualities, Goyle higher grade fuels are further fortified with the XP3 additive multifunctional enhancer, which makes your vehicle more efficient and eco-friendly and will be sold to you at no extra cost. Goyle higher grade fuels come in Goyle Super XP Ron 95 and Diesel XP, which are sold at every Goyle station across Ghana and not just selected filling stations. So fill up today with Goyle higher grade fuels because Ajibibia, Goyle, good energy. Goyle, Yayedim.
Okay, I thought you were going to miss that bit out. Yayedim. Paying taxes, customs duties, and all other GR payments has been made easy at any GC, CBG bank branch nationwide. You can also dial *222# to pay your customs duties, GRA taxes, Environmental Protection Agency levies, Ghana Standards Authority levies, Food and Drugs Authority levies, and levies for all other government services. Visit www.ghana.gov.gh to fill in your forms and generate your invoice. This is a number that Mark needs to write down. The number is 0302-216-000. So go, Mark, and pay your GRA payments today. You've got customs duties. I know you've been in a container or two. And then you've got to pay Environmental Protection Agency fees because you're doing an environmental impact assessment somewhere. So whatever you're doing, as a CBG is making it easier for you to do that. You took the number down, did you?
Yeah, I took the number down.
Excellent. Great. So
16000.
There you go. And remember that the moment in time that GR is pointing out that this whole registration of TIN and the national identity card and things like that, let's be very clear. You can go to the GRA center, to the GRA offices, the main ones, and register the whole service through GRA, those offices, okay? You can do that now. Okay, so moving on. With time at 9:30, the gentlemen are all still here. I'm happy that education captures everybody's imagination the way it does, because, I mean, at the end of the day, that's all we've got. Our only real legacy is our kids. So we better get it right for them. Ni Ama Adi, governance expert, research fellow of the Center for Social Justice, and of course, keen educationist and argumentative soul. Mark Ewusi Akun, People's National Convention, PNC, National Youth Organizer, still rabble-rousing. And Dr. Fred Amankwa Safo, president of the Doctoral Researchers Association, newly acquired Safo, added to his name. At 9:30 exactly. Moving on.
But Mr. Minister, do you know that as
no,
we speak
I don't
this
know
morning,
anything. And
Education see? Watch and CDD are meeting the Select Committee on Education in Parliament this morning to
no, I don't.
Present some research work they've done on how government can implement the free TVET education and basic education. Right. You know, and I don't know how much more we'll discuss into
We're not
education.
Going to discuss anymore.
Okay, but 1 minute. If you look at the OECD report,
no, we don't look at the OECD
on quality
report.
Of.
We are not going to look at
on quality of, on quality of education.
We smuggle it.
You know, the basics are always very important, and I mean this OECD report tells us how various countries are doing with their basic education. I mean, if you go to Scandinavia, which is always a very good example, Finland, Denmark, Sweden, etc. Mm. The levels
say,
of quality.
Please, I'm going to say stop. You have populations that are one third to a quarter of the size of the population you're dealing with in a developing country.
Oh, you're
and you're
models,
doing comparisons.
Models.
Models that work in a very specific environment because they're starting from a point where they already have a system that's controllable.
Mr. Benson, if you know how many graduates we have, and Dr. Fred will give us the statistics, there who we can channel into, I mean, basic education. It's very huge.
Okay. All right. All right.
Anyway, I'm sure we'll have another time to discuss.
I'm sure we will.
This needs a whole program.
Yes.
A whole dialogue.
This is new to the whole day.
Yes. Whole day. Okay.
Yes. All right.
You know, there are very exciting things there that we can look at.
He's excited.
That's
okay,
good.
But before we go, we do have to talk about one other thing that came up, unfortunately. It's a shame that we have to move, but the other issue that's... it's troubled everybody, I'm sure, as this issue. What came up was the story of this tragic story of a child in care in a facility where she'd been sent a creche, one of the watchers, one of the carers, decided to force feed the child, which. Led to the child's ultimate demise. Allegra Yaba Akamensa, pronounced dead at the North Legon Hospital, where she was rushed by the managers of the creche. Happy Bloomers creche, and the caregiver was a 54-year-old. Closed circuit TV, several of you must have seen it. And I want a general comment before I ask any question. Mark, did you get a chance to hear about this caregiver story?
What was your
first reaction?
Yes, it is so unfortunate, and this is to me not the first time it is happening. It's been happening, just that we don't hear of them, and for us to get known of these things, I think proper policies and reviews ought to be implemented. And I'm sure at the end of time, we'll try to look at bringing finality to some of these challenging troubles. Of course, it boils down to issues of policies and its implementations.
It's about policies.
Yes. So if I'm to continue.
No, I'll come back to you. I've got to ask a question, but I just wanted your first thoughts.
Yes, very, very, very tragic. I mean, I heard it. I listened to the detailed discussion on the subject, and I mean, I couldn't control myself with the emotions of what happened. An 11-month-old baby. Again, to conclude, it's an issue of educational policy challenge, which we have to look at.
It's an educational policy. You're challenge, both looking at it being something other than purely. I'm curious about that, Dr.
Well, unfortunate incident, and to think that you take your child to a care
center,
uh-huh. and then he comes back dead. It's really a bad experience, and my condolences to the family. And yes, policy important. And the people who we entrust our children to. Okay. Now the managers of the crèche, we have to really look at the people who, what type of training do we give? Sometimes psychological as well. This is a mother, 54 years, and this child could probably pass for a grandchild. And we know how Ghanaians sometimes our mothers handle us. So it's very, very unfortunate. Let's get the investigators finish their inquiries, and then we can know the factors that contributed to it. If it is policy, let's look at policy. If it is the qualification of people, the psychological makeup of people we entrust, especially very tender age children to them, that this is a very, very serious and tragic phenomenon that we have.
Right. There are policies for this country, and let's not, there are policies. We're not going to get into all of that because we don't have the time, but we do have existing daycare policies that exist for our young ones in this country. We do have them. How far that they are implemented, requirements in Ghana law do exist for all daycare centers. Do the institutions operate under these policies properly? Are they licensed? Are they inspected? Is there what now you talked about and what I want to focus on is the training, you know, and whether or not that is and licensing. And I do know that a lot of young people who have gone into this business, they do go for training, and there are schools where you can learn how to look after young kids and daycare, things like that. So we're not behind in that respect. That one I know for a fact. So when you say policy, what are you talking about, Mark?
Yes, so Uncle Goju, I think you've made us understood. Yes, we know that there are policies, but the rightful implementation of the policy is what is challenging. Now, childcare is a serious business. For a parent to leave his or her child in the care of another person is a serious decision to take. We find ourselves in a society where we ought to go out to find, you know, our daily bread. And without that, there's no way one can, you know, feed the family. And so we tend to leave our children in the care of these caregivers. But it has to do with people who have love to take care of children, people who have the passion, and then people who have interest. Because taking care of babies is not a joke. It is never a joke at all. And so if you don't get people who have that passion and love, it becomes so difficult. For instance, there are children who have different kinds of attitudes and behavior. There are some kids who, when you put the food in their mouth, quickly they swallow. But there are some kids, their parents, especially their mothers, would have to sing for them, dance, for the children to start laughing before they take just a bite. And for the child to take another bite, you ought to go through the same process. And these people who are employed into this care, you know, giving centers, to me, do not have the requisite training. There are people who have, you know, come out with institutions or let me call it training centers that trains, you know, young people into this Montessori schools.
Right.
They'll go to school for just 3 months and 6 months, and they think they are done. Mm. 3 months and 6 months, and you think you are done.
Right.
When someone is going through a formal education at UCC for 3 good years, just to go and take care of nursery one children.
Mm-hmm.
And so when you go to three months and 6 months, you think you are done. And you see, these private people managing our daycare centers, as you said, it's a policy that is there for Ghana. How many daycare centers do we have as a state? Mm. It takes the private people to set them up.
Mm.
And when they set them up, the challenge we have is that when government tries to go there with their policies, these private people intend to reject them. They reject them because they seem not to receive any goodies from government or any support from government. And so why should government come in to sort of detect to them? When we're introducing the free SHS policy, we saw what happened. That the private schools didn't want to accept it because maybe it may go against them when it comes to their collection of their fees and collection of one or two things. So they tried to object it. And this same thing is happening at our daycare centers. A policy ought to come out, and it should be included in what the policy we have today. At age or month 3 or 4, parents begin taking their children to school because they have to go to work. Yes, I understand. Can we come out with a scenario or a position where, if we're talking about, let's say, MPA, we have women who work there. Can they get just a room?
Build a crèche.
Build a crèche, you know,
in
there.
And all the offices have a crèche or facility for a certain age group.
That is it. We should begin looking at that. When you come to our government schools in relation to these crèche issues we're talking about, you can go to Gawest, and you can count just about 4 schools, which are not even government schools. And so how do we bring... And we have women who give birth to children and have to go to work, leave their children in the care of others. The best we should have even been doing is that when a lady gives birth, it is the mother who comes to take care of the child for her. But now the scenario has changed. The mothers cannot come simply because maybe there are some financial challenges or difficulties. Let's allow our children to attain the age of 2 before we send them to school. What is the child going to learn at month 3? Or month 6? Right. Or month 11? You see, so we should look at all those things. Now, there should be a consistent dialogue in addressing some of these issues. When we speak about it, it comes, we talk about it, and then we leave it to go. Mostly what we do as a nation is, when we only wait for the issues or challenges to hit us before we begin acting. Now, in sense of acting, we just bring some immediate solution to the challenges, and we tend to forget because we think we've solved it. But we shouldn't forget that it may have a long-lasting difficulties and challenges that will come with it again. Now, these Montessoris should be properly looked at by the Education Ministry. Whoever goes through that system must be ensured that he's been able to attain or acquire the requisite skill and be given the needed certification before he or she is employed into some of these caregiving centers for him or her to work. If not so, Uncle Joe would be here and the issues will keep popping up. Some of them, we may hear them, and some we will not hear. And I was very happy this came into social media. Others were saying that, but why did the owner or the manager of the school allow this to come? And I said, yeah, it is good for it to come. Because a lot of things are happening when children, innocent children, are. This we can't say is a mirage. This we can't say is just a misfortune. It is different from you sitting in a car for the car to be involved in an accident for you to die. It is a different thing altogether. But the child who is under the care of a caregiver forcefully give food to the child, holding the hands tight at the back.
I think that with that, I don't want to defend this caregiver at all, and I really do apologize if I come across it like that. But we can always see the thing that we see because we know the result. Now we say, oh, that was very bad and everything else. Because we know the result. And I know mothers who would do exactly the same thing. Mothers who love their kids to death would do exactly the same thing that this caregiver gave, as far as those pictures are concerned. So we don't know. Obviously, she wasn't trying to kill the child. you know, so, and that's what I'm saying. I don't want to sound sympathetic towards her. So we don't know the circumstance a little bit. She wasn't beating the child or anything like that. So it's just a very tragic situation. But so I don't want us to judge her too much. But you're talking about basically the general care that is provided to children at that level.
Uncle, do you see?
Just some things again.
You see, parents sometimes, out of frustrations, you know, subject their children to some of these things we're talking about. But it wouldn't be as
severe?
As severe as a person who...
I'm sorry.
I'm not defending parents. As to someone who is not a true or biological mother of that child. I am not too sure that a mother will subject his or her child to this level.
Mark, fine, we'll hold it there. You're not too sure.
Yes, Mr. Benson, when I spoke about educational policy challenge, I mean, our preschools are not under the GES.
Well, according to what I was reading, they are required to register.
Yes. But the monitoring etc.
Yeah.
Goes to the gender ministry and all that. So to what extent do they monitor those schools to ensure that those policies are adhered to? So one,
whether a policy would have impacted this tragedy.
Yes, yes. And I want to outline a few of the things in my reflections. I see our nurses finish nursing training school and they are always picketing, as they say, for not being
posted.
Why can't we have the policy? Because early childhood education is more of health issues than teaching the child at 3 months anything. Why don't we have them posted to all these nursery schools as a way of a service, even if it's 6 months, 1 month before their national posting come, and they are being paid by the school, if we have a policy direction to this? So you know that at least the health of the child is in the hands of a professional who knows what food to give the child, how to take care of the child, etc., etc.
And also deal with an emergency.
And deal with emergency for the child. So that is one thing that I want to put forth there. The second thing is got to do with...
You know that all of these facilities are supposed to have a medical person on site, or the person training first.
Yes, that's what I'm saying. So even if we don't have them, put them as a national service people there, in a way.
Mm-hmm.
And not government taking the cost, the burden, but being borne by the schools because they necessarily have to have it
as
by the policy that we should. Yes,
right.
That's the thing. So that's one. Two, we're looking at nursing education in our various teacher training schools.
Mm.
We need to introduce a whole nursing education as part of it. So you go to do education, but you do nursing education.
You're talking about nursing in terms of looking after young children.
Children, that's
right.
It.
Okay.
In education.
Right.
Okay, in education aspect.
Understand.
So that is there. And then you talk about educational guidance and counseling, which is a necessity for every educational setup to have. Why don't we have it? Even at the adult age, at the school levels. I mean, from basic schools all the way to the senior high school, even to the universities.
Mm-hmm.
Go there and see if you have how many guidance and counseling units you have taking care of these things. Okay, even if not for educational guidance, for what we call pastoral care, how to take care of the children, how to make sure they are fine, who is advising these teachers, who is taking care of the children?
Mm.
But it's the whole thing becomes like another business opportunity. We have facilities. We set up the preschools, we put a few people there, charge some money, and get it running without having the necessary human resource that is required.
Mm.
And then, yes, so I'm sure that... So that's what brings me to my educational policy challenges.
Mm.
That if we can put some of these things straight, some of these problems can be addressed effectively. Mm. Because the thing is, if we don't get it very right at the beginning, it's going to affect the child continuously. And we all know the impact of good food, nutrition, to the development of the brain and all that. Who even advises the parents as to what food the children are supposed to eat? Or we just pay their feeding fee in school and they are given anything.
Right.
And at that age, they don't tell you what they are being fed on. You can go ask and they will show you something on paper. Mm. But what goes in there, how do we know? Unless the professionals does these things.
Well, look, I mean, one of the things we do have to celebrate with this school, despite the tragedy, is that they even had a camera. the CCTV that was operational, that was working, wasn't just pretending to work. And that was what the evidence that was used by the police in arresting this 54-year-old woman. Fred.
I think that this is bad news, but we also have to acknowledge the importance of the creche over the years. They've done well. This is one too many, but they have done well. Looking at the economic circumstances now, children by 6 months, nursing mothers, I think 3 months or so, they have to go back to work. And few firms or few organizations have special places where, and even we are looking at organizations. Mm. Look at our mothers who go to the markets, and even those who go to the farm. They need somebody to take care of their children. So the creche, the Montessori schools are doing well. And this school, I'm sure that it's one of the good schools to find around. They had CCTVs. It means that they acknowledge the need to be watching
to be monitoring
and then maybe giving counseling and training to people who may not act according to this thing. But you see, the inspectorate division of our schools. Recently, the National Schools Inspectorate Authority, an agency under the ministry, which is mandated by Parliament. But there again, there were issues of recertifying some of these schools, and they had to pay so much in order to be accepted as a school with the mandate to train kids. Let's not rush too much. The story that came said the anger, and this is the report of the police.
Mm-hmm.
You see, so it's not so much about
The failure of policy.
Mm-hmm. The anger of the caregiver is what had culminated into the death of the child, and yes, very unfortunate.
Fred, then I'm going to argue with you on that and say simply, that might not have been touched on, but pastoral care and even psychological counseling,
yes,
that you are dealing with children under the age of five. They are a different breed of animal.
Yes. Yeah.
So you even have to be trained specially to do that.
Yes.
It's a policy.
Yes, it is. It is. And that's very important. So in my earlier submission, I said that, look, the training, the psychological makeup of the people who have the mandate to take care of these children, how are we assessing them again and again? It shouldn't be one time. Even if you go through school for 3 years and you have... The theory is quite different from what you experience practically. Mm. So it's an inspector going around and checking. Mm. And if we have CCTV now with a smart system, with our smartphones, you can have a CCTV on your phone. So probably managers would also be occasionally, who is monitoring the CCTV? Because if somebody was monitoring the CCTV footages and they had seen this, an intervention could have sufficed rather than waiting for the child. If the person is feeding the child and he's not doing it right, and you have CCTV footage, real-time watching that, you can even watch it on your phone.
Do you not think that if the person who was doing the feeding feared the camera, mm-hmm. obviously they knew the camera was in the room.
Yes.
She didn't actually think she was doing anything wrong.
Yes.
Or she wouldn't have been doing it in front of a camera.
Then she might have some psychological issues that might be taken care of. If she knew all this and she was doing it right, then we have to look at her psychological makeup. But the story from the police says that she was angry.
Angry, yeah.
So if she was angry, then she wasn't acting professionally. Mm-hmm. She was doing something with emotion.
Which is where the managers of the school will not be exonerated from this. Because they are vicarious.
Well, so probably to let's ask Obi questions. Has she been paid? What is her employment relation like? How is she treated? All of these things must be taken care of before we can have a conclusive.
There's so many other factors.
Those will be mitigating factors. But the fact that she's done what she's done will not...
No one exonerates her for her action.
Yeah.
But what I mean is that this is something we've seen. Maybe she died because the child died. If the child had not died and had been affected emotionally,
yeah.
or even at that tender age, a brain, anything could have happened to her.
You would have known.
And you wouldn't know when she goes and she's not developing well. You wouldn't know why she's gone through this.
Well, if we get it wrong at the foundation.
Yes. So we should look at it holistically and then come up with something that...
Review. Of what we're doing and what we're getting wrong.
Mr. Minister, there's a lot of avenues for work. Oh. Because if thousands of these nursery schools, they are monitoring, if it's under Ministry for Gender. Like, they can employ plenty of people to do the monitoring, surcharge all these schools who do not comply to the thing, and pay some money. Charlie should give me the project. I'll do it.
But it's such an easy,
Would you send a bill?
That's true.
I would.
You would.
You see, this is.
No, I'll do with you.
For a little brief moment in a child's cycle, they have absolutely no method of dealing of reporting. You know, when they're seven, they can open their mouths and talk. But at this age, there is no report I can give to anybody of how I'm being treated.
But Mr. Minister, you know, the other thing is, at early ages when the children could talk and they even tell you and you go to ask, then there's school.
Just 1 minute. Wrap up. What?
Uncle, do you see? Dr. Fed made mention of maternal leave system. Okay. We need to recognize the fact that our women and our children are our fulcrum for the next generation. I'm not saying men are not part. I'm not saying men are not part. So let us have a conscious effort in getting a review for our maternal leaves. 3 months, 6 months. The child may be going through a lot of difficulties for a year, and the mother would have to go to work. If you don't go to work, you lose your job and all that. So let's give a special concentration and care to our mothers and our children.
Unfortunately, it won't deal with the problem. It's only in an organized environment that this leave system you're talking about is even operational. In a informal sector, which is by far the biggest sector, that is the market woman. Mm-hmm. She has nobody that she's taking leave from. She is her own employer.
And uncle, even our market women will still have to go and leave their children under the care of these people. So when in past times, Sunedu Ajman Rawlings, former first lady, was able to build schools, crutches close to market areas. What have happened to all these things?
All right. There's got to be an improvement in our policy. It seems that the policy is the way forward. Let's be clear. Early childhood care and development standards from 0 to 3 was published in March of 2018 by the Minister of Gender, Children and Social Protection. Okay? So the early childhood care and development standards were published in 2018. That's the book of record from the Ministry of Gender. That's what they're using now. All right. And so in it is a lot of the information of what you're talking about. But it sets out a very basic map profile of what should happen, what the expectations are for the different care groups. But it's specifically for children 2-3. Yeah. So it's pretty comprehensive. Yeah. Now, it's about the implementation.
Yeah.
And that's where the falling down begins. The standards being set. Nana, your final word on this.
Well, this is where I found this discussion problematic, apart from a certain level of sentimentality about the motivation of parents and, their ability to cause harm to their own children. Let's not forget what Profanji was talking about earlier on in the program, just before we started our discussion, and the discussion that she's going to have this evening about child sexual abuse and how that's very, very often perpetrated by people in their own families. And yes, I don't believe that, I mean, most mothers wouldn't want to treat their own child that way, but there are mothers who do, and worse, they do worse things to their children. Not necessarily particularly in this country, but they exist. We talk about this as if it's happening in a vacuum and as if we can create an ideal system overnight. Apart from the problem of the implementation of the policy, all these things cost money. I know from somebody who works as a nursery nurse, teaching precisely these sort of age kids in the United Kingdom, that it is an extraordinarily tough job. She is very limited in class sizes, a bit like what you saw in the Happy Bloomers School in Agbogba, ironic name. But she also has vast amounts of paperwork that she has to fill in.
On the regular.
On the regular. Mm-hmm. She also has, for example, a teaching assistant with her at virtually all points in the day. So nothing is ever left to one person. If you have a special needs child in your school, they have to have a dedicated carer with them, and so on and so on. And that is in a system where you have very good tax cushions that enable that to be possible. It is still paid for by the parents. Mm-hmm. They pay up to £195 a week for the privilege of keeping their kid in that subsidized school.
And therein lies the question. Are parents willing to pay the right kind of money for the right kind of service? It's all very well saying, I want my child in a creche. Will I pay what is deserved by the nursery attendants?
Yes.
There's this thing where we think, No,
it goes beyond that.
There are people who take their children to nursery untoilet trained, and they expect the nursery caregiver to train their children for them. They expect them to feed them. They expect to be able to talk at the caregiver and berate them and criticize their quality of childcare when they are not subjected to the same standards.
Not to defend
looking
anything.
After children is a very hard job. Yeah. If we want it to work well for our children, we have to be prepared to pay for it.
This is not to defend in any way what has happened at Happy Bloomers.
No.
And not to say that for 1 minute we are supporting any of that, but we're just looking at the much broader picture. We want to ask the Ministry of Social Welfare. According to them, the Department of Children will be required to commission a biannual, if that's every 2 years, assessment of the progress of implementation of all of the standards captured in the report of 2018. This is the year 2021. Where's the last report? Social welfare inspections are supposed to be conducted at all these facilities. It's all captured in this. There's been no further assessment since 2018. What's going on?
Plenty of employment creation.
There's so many jobs.
So many.
Inspectors.
So many.
I mean, there's
so many.
We'll do it. Potential Dr. that you have, to spend the money up, you have to spend the money up front to create the system, which is a problem. But a message from Tabia Herbal, which has the following herbal medicines to improve your health. Tabia Herbal Mixture for the treatment of all forms of fever, including severe malarial fever, general body pain, and loss of appetite. Tabia Zanica Herbal Mixture for your general well-being, which boosts your immune system and aids in fighting all viruses and bacteria. And Tabia Herbal Capsules, which cleanse and detoxify the body. All of these are available at leading pharmacies and herbal shops across Ghana. For more information, contact Tabia Herbal on 024 368 6861 or 024 579 9206. Tabia Herbal and Zanica Mixture, Wunsunumbi. A note of caution, these medications are not recommended for pregnant women, lactating mothers, or children under the age of 12.
All right. And on that note, we're going to say bye-bye. Ni Ama Adi is a government expert and governance expert and research fellow of the Center for Social Justice and keen educationist and lecturer. Mark Ewusiaku, People's National Convention, PNC, National Youth Organizer. Dr. Fred Amankwa Safo, president of the Doctoral Researchers Association. Two issues came up today. Of course, the president's speech on accepting his honorary doctorate, and other comments that led into other discussions generally around the issue of education, where Ni Ama Adi reigned and won the competition hands down for who talked most.
He's the educationist.
And so I want to say thanks to our guests, as always, for coming in. I'll be back. Of course, they'll be back next week, but we'll be back same time tomorrow morning, 5:30. My name is Kujumensa. Her name is? Have a great day. Coming up next is the news at the top of the hour.
The Asasi Breakfast Show.